going to tell us about imaginaries in value differential fields.
Yeah. So this is going to be the first part of our two-part talk, and the second part is going to happen this afternoon. Because, well, it's naturally separates into two things that you have to prove, and one of them is very much more pure model theory than the other, so this is what we're going to do this afternoon, but we'll get there eventually. So so what am I trying to speak about? So I want to talk about so two things, imaginaries. And contractive value fields. So I don't know which one I should start with by defining. So maybe let's start with the object, and then I'll explain what I want to prove about them later. So, so contractive valued fields are where the model theory of them was first studied by Tom Scanlon in his PhD thesis, and so the idea is to look at valued fields with a differential, as the name can indicate, where the differential and the valuation interact in a nice way. So the nice way is that you require that the valuation. So you have your field with a valuation and a differential, and you require that the valuation of the differential is always greater than the valuation of the point, which is the other way around from what you would expect. Because if you take, for example, C of T, and you take the usual valuation on the bar series, and you take the usual differential, then this is not contracted, yeah? Because V of t is 1 and V of dt is 0. So
are
it goes down.
Assuming the range of the valuation is the reals or something?
No, I'm not assuming anything.
So it could be an ordered group?
Or? Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, my valuations are completely, yeah. Okay. They're not rank one, they can be whatever you wish. So in that case it is, but... So also because I want to do model theory for those things, I will have to allow very large value groups. Yeah, so this is not what we're talking about. What we are talking about is C of t with the usual valuation, but a slightly weird derivation, which is the unique continuous derivation that says that such that t is a constant. Right? So it's the derivation that if you have a series, the derivation is just this is completely silly because C is has trivial derivation of it. So this is not what I want, sorry.
Oh. Yeah.
What we're talking about is you take a differential field, and now you take the derivation that acts on the coefficients. Right, because if the differential here is trivial, then you'll just get the trivial differential everywhere, which is not, well.
Is differential equals important here?
Well, no, it's not. It's, well, what we're going to look at eventually, as we always do, is existentially closed models of this thing. So it's going to be, the residue field is going to be DCSU. But I agree. You take K to be your favorite differential field. All right, so that's a typical...
And is the derivation the one on k, the one that makes t 0?
No, well, no. You have a differential on k, and that's the one you use to act on the coefficients. So dt, I extend it...
Extension.
I extend it from k to the series by making it act trivially on the new variable. Okay, so actually you can do, this is not yet the typical example of the things I want to look at, because here I have value group Z, which is not really what I want. I want any possible value group. So really the typical example I'm going to look at is really a Hahn field. So this is the Hahn field over Z. Well, the fraction field of that is the Hahn field over Z. So this is the series, so the formal series, such that the set of gamma with a gamma not zero is well ordered. So this is naturally a field. Yes.
So for this example, the word contractor is a little bit misleading, because your inequality is always an equality.
No.
Constant coefficients.
Oh, you can have constant coefficients. Thank you. Okay.
Yes, you do okay. Contract things.
Okay. Thank you.
What?
No,
it's a gamma.
Gamma.
Yeah, that's so gamma. That's a value. That's an ordered group. So if I have a field, I can build this thing, which is called a Hahn field, which is a valued field for the valuation. So you put the valuation on this thing, which is the minimum of this set. And so if you take gamma to be Z, you exactly have the fraction field of this thing. But you also, if you take gamma to be Q, you have the Puiseux series. All right, so this is the typical thing I want to look at, with the derivation I just described above. So with this T equals 0, and you extend the derivation on K. So we want to do a little. We probably want to explain exactly how do we look at these things. So we are going to work in a rather natural language, which is that we're going to look at the language of rings, and we're going to add, well, the differential rings. So we add a symbol for our derivation, and we'll add a symbol which is interpreted as v of x is smaller than v of y. And then you can easily write a theory of, so the class of, is that?
Yes.
The class of valued differential contractible fields is elementary. Essentially, have to explain that this is a valuation, but that's not very complicated. And you have to explain that this is a derivation, which is also okay. And you have to write that it's contractible, but that's also very easy, because you just say that x divides dx. Okay, and so you have a class of contractible. Just a little word about the whole contractible thing. Nobody agrees on how you should call them. In Tom's PhD, I think he carefully avoids giving them a name. Then I think some people called it contractible, or maybe he calls them derivation preserving valuation or something like that. Lau, Johan, and Matthias, in their work on trend series, call them monotone. So people don't agree, but I'm going to call them contractible because that's how I like calling them. But they are also named otherwise. So this is the class of things we want to look at, and the next move, which is the usual move when we want to do model theory, is to look at the existentially closed search fields. And so a theorem of Tom. is that the existentially closed, this theory has a model completion. So the existentially closed So is it clear what existentially closed means for everyone, or? Yeah, perfect. Such fields are form an elementary class. Once again, people don't agree on how you should call it, but I'm going to call it the way I usually call it, which is VDF EC. So this is for valued differential field, which is kind of bad because it forget to specify that it's contractive, and EC is for existentially closed. Okay, so maybe I should describe what that class is and what the models look like. So the models really look like these things where gamma, where k is DCF0 and gamma is divisible. So, if you have k, model of DCF0, and gamma is divisible, then k t gamma, with the derivation described over there, is existentially closed.
Look a lot like T's.
Yes.
Is there anything you can do to maybe
make them? Oh, I could call them G's.
Oh, call them G's, great.
All right, so let me quickly describe how do we show that? Well, no, not how do we show it's elementary, but at least give the axioms to show of this class. So, so the first thing we need to say is so we say that something has enough constants. Yeah, it's the name of my variable.
Oh, sorry.
No,
it doesn't look like a T.
It's a small T, supposedly. Is that better?
No, you want the line to go all the way through.
Oh, right there.
Yeah.
That's how you write a T?
Yes.
Yes.
And then there's a tail.
Oh, if it's crypt, yes, then I agree.
Yeah.
I don't know, anyway.
Beautiful.
I call them X.
Right.
X, yeah, we'll see. So these fields have a property, which is that they have enough constants. That is that if you look at the value group of the constant field, so this is my notation for the constant field. This is exactly the same as the valuation of the field itself. So let me put a little stars to say, because I want the actual value group and not the thing of with the infinity around, but it's the same. So any valuation is also the valuation of a constant. Okay, and then we have another property, which is that somehow. These things are very complete, so they are maximally complete. It means that they have every chain of balls has a point in it. And so we want to have a first order expression of that. So if we don't have a derivation around, this is usually expressed by being Hansilian. So we want a version of that that takes in account the derivation, which is what we're going to call d-Hansilian. So what does the Hansilianity mean? Well, if we take a polynomial, differential polynomial over k, that I will write as p of x0 xn. I wanted to build the valuation ring. So that's the ring of things that have positive valuation. If I have a differential polynomial over the valuation ring, and I have a point in the valuation ring, such that A looks like it's a solution in the sense that the valuation of this thing is strictly positive. So we're somewhat close to a solution. And P is not singular at A. So the minimum over I of dP dxi at A, so the valuation of that is 0. So one of the derivatives has low valuation. Yes?
And so this is the formal derivative of the n plus 1 variable polynomial P with respect to the ith variable, right?
Yes. Yeah, so yes. That's what it is. Then you have an actual solution. There is V in O such that P of V equals 0. We don't want B to be completely anywhere. We want it to be close to A. So we want V of V minus A to be positive. Yeah, so what we're saying is that if we have a normal solution of a reasonable polynomial close by, we have an actual solution.
Is that curly bracket for polynomial, or is it?
Yeah, I used curly brackets because I wanted the differential polynomials, but
yes, that's the standard.
I think it is. Yeah, my curly brackets are horrible. That's what's your point. So now we can describe VDF. Well, VDF ici. VDF we already described. So the class VDF ici says that the field is dihensilian. I need this move. It should be reasonably clear to everyone that this is an axiom. It is not an axiom, but that's a scheme of axioms where you have one axiom for each degree, well, possible degrees and order. You said that you have enough constants, so that's very easy to express. You say that the residue field, so which is O mod its maximal ideal, is a model of DC of 0. I forgot the obvious. I forgot to say that D was contractive. So the fact that D is contractive means that you get a well-defined derivation on the residue field, and then you have that this thing is DC of 0. And so actually, I should probably also I'll add it, but. And then the last thing you want, so V of K star, so the value group to be divisible. And I'll just add non-trivial. Because otherwise you get annoying, silly behaviors. So that's the class of field I want to look at. And so the interesting fact is that these are existentially closed. And so the models I described earlier, so our K of T G, where G was divisible and that was the model of DC at zero, are indeed model of these things because, well, it's easy to see that the differential I defined is contractive. It's easy to see that it has an F constant because the constant field is actually C small k of T gamma. Which has the same valuation group, which is G. And the fact that it's d-encilian comes from the fact that it's complete, in the same way that you show that if you have a complete field, then it's encilian, by some Newton approximation type theorem. Because, yeah, so you start with your approximate solution and you get a slightly better solution, and you go on. And whenever you have if you're not rank, if you rank one, you just take the limit of that thing, and you get a point. If you're not rank one, whenever you have infinitely many, well, you take a limit and then you go on until you find an actual solution. So I think that describes the theory we want to look at. Let me give another theorem of Tom's, which was implicit in when I said the other theorem out loud, which was that it was a model completion, but wasn't explicit in the way I wrote it because I just said that they were existentially closed, which is that this theory eliminates quantifiers.
VDF.
Oh, yes. So the one question that you might, any person that has ever, well, no, any model theorist that has ever looked at the differential field might immediately wonder about is, are those fields differentially closed? They're not. Far from it. So there is Tom proved that if you're filled with a contractive, well, actually, just with a continuous derivation, you can't be differentially closed. In that case, it's even easier to see that it's not differentially closed because actually in the differential ring, well, in the differential field, you can see the valuation already. So K model of this DDF is not differentially closed. And if you just look at the differential field, so actually the valuation ring is defined by they exist to y such that x y equals dy. Because it's contractible, this is all in the valuation ring. And because it's d-encilian, you can actually this is actually the full valuation ring, and so they're clearly not differentially closed because you have some new thing around. Okay, so those are the fields we want to look at. So the second thing I want to talk about is what do I want to prove about these things. And so what I want to prove about this thing is that they eliminate imaginaries. So once again, I'm not completely sure I know what any of you know about imaginaries, so I'm going to quickly recall what they are. So when we have a theory in the language, so T is an L theory. We say that T eliminates imaginaries. If for all L definable, so L definable, I mean without parameters. For all L definable E and D, where E lives on the square of D and is a and is an equivalence relation such that so T proves that E is an equivalence relation, which is a first order sentence. Then we can find an F, which is also L-definable, which represents the quotient. Okay, so F such that T proves that for X, for Y, F of X, Y, F of is equal to F of Y, if and only if X is equivalent to Y. So why do we care about this property? It's, well, the main reason is because if you look at the category of L-definable sets in T, it's not closed under quotients. And this tells you that it's, well, this property tells you that it's actually closed under quotients. So, which, well, is practical for many reasons. So why do we care about those questions? Well, one of the main reason why such an equivalence relation can appear is to construct moduli spaces. Well, I should put quotation marks. But, so if you have a formula phi of xy where x and y might be tuples, you can look at, so you can really see it, I really see it as a family of definable set in X when Y varies. And you can ask, well, I can define Y1 to be equivalent to Y2 if for X, phi of X, Y1 is the same as phi of X, Y2. And so this is obviously an equivalence relation. And so elimination of imaginaries tell me that that in a theory that eliminates imaginaries, I can find a formula, well, I can find an F. Well, actually, yes. I can find an F such that phi of M A, well, how do I want to phrase it? Well, let me rephrase it slightly differently. So elimination of imaginaries implies that I can find a formula psi of xy, of xz, with a new parameter, such that psi, well, such that every psi of m a, so m is some model of the theory, any model of the theory, and a is in my, only appears once. And every phi of M C appears once. So really, you find you can find another family where every which represents this other family, but in a much more canonical way. Because every fiber appears only once, which in a way means that now if you look at the space of Z, it's really the definable set that parametrizes the fibers of this family. So in a way, yes. So the space of Z is a moduli space for the fibers of this thing, which is one of the main reasons we care about this elimination of imaginary construction, because if we don't have elimination of imaginaries, we can't do that. Because the Z morally lives in a quotient. Well, I mean, exactly lives in a quotient. So I will need a technical tool invented by Shah, which allows us to always eliminate imaginaries. Because, well, essentially what we're saying is that we want a theory where we have all the quotients around. And so one easy way of doing that is just to brutally add all the quotients. So when we have a theory T, we're going to build a new theory T in the language LEQ, where we add one sort SE for each E equivalence relation, L definable equivalence relation, and a function FE. And TEQ says that FE is the canonical projection. Well, sorry. So SE. So yeah, maybe if that's the word, so bother anyone? Oh, yes, it does not. Perfect. I'm so happy about that. So SE is really, well, so no, what it says is that and FE of XY, well, sorry, FE of X equals FE of Y, if and only if, I don't have enough room. X, E, Y. So, yeah, so the theory TQ tells us that that really the sort SE is interpreted as the quotient, and that FE is the canonical projection. And so in the theory TQ, it's not very hard to see that you have elimination of the matrix. So it seems like a completely trivial statement. It's not a completely trivial statement because we added some structure, so we also have to check that the quotients that we might have added are also eliminated. But we didn't really add any structure, because if we look at the initial sorts we had, everything that's definable on this these initial sorts in LEQ is already definable in L, and so out of that you easily get elimination of matrices. Okay, so. So that's a way you can always eliminate imaginaries. So that calls for a second question, which is, if we can always eliminate imaginaries, why do we care? The answer is essentially the same as for quantified elimination, because we can also always force quantified elimination. But in a way, if we start with a practical application in mind, this is useless, because it doesn't give us any information. Whereas if we do prove elimination of imaginaries in a precise language, it will give us a fair amount of information. So probably it's time for a few examples. So. In the paper where Poisat defines elimination of imaginaries, the first two examples he immediately gives are algebraically closed fields and differentially closed fields. So if you think about it in more algebraic terms, what it means is that whenever you have an affine variety, so the first one means that whenever you have an affine variety, you can find a smaller field of definition for the variety. And in there it says the same thing essentially for differential affine varieties. And actually the two statements are equivalent. Okay, so I'm going to come back later on how we prove elimination of imaginaries for DCF0, because as you can guess, once we add evaluation, we still have a differential around, so it will be interesting to understand how it works in DCF0. But first, what happens with if we have evaluation? So if we look at algebraically closed valued fields, So in the language I described earlier, except without the differential, or if with the differential, with the derivation being trivial, but that's not. So in this language, they do not have the I. The reason is the following. Well, you have a quotient around. Well, you have many quotients around, but the first problem is this one. And so you have models of ACF. So that's the value group. And you have models of ACVF where the value group is countable, but the structure is uncountable. And every definable subset of a power of the algebraic closed set has non-empty interior, so in particular it has to be uncountable. So there can not be a bijection between gamma and something inside the field. You have another problem, which is the residuum field, which same thing. You can have it can be way too small to be interpretable in the field itself. Well, to be definable in the field itself. So. And you have a higher dimension equivalent of these things, and so a result of Haskell, Ruchowski, and MacPherson is essentially that this is the only thing you really need to add. So let me phrase that properly. All right. So once again, we could just add every imaginary. We can also add much less. So I can define what's called the geometric language for value fields. So we define Sn to be GLn K over GLn O. Note that S1 is exactly V of K star. And we define Tn to be a slightly larger quotient by some weird group that I'm going to define right now. So this is the matrices in GLn O, whose reduction mod the maximal ideal are of the form. So the last so you have whatever you want here, and the last column is all zeros, except a 1 on the diagonal. So what are those sets supposed to be? So if you have an element of Sn, what it really amounts to is specifying a rank n free O submodule of K. So Sn specifies a basis for rank n O submodule of Kn. So what are usually called lattices in number theory? So Sn is really the space of these things. Because if you have a rank n free, did I remember to say free? No, free. Also module of kn. It is generated by a basis of kn as a k vector space, and two bases generate the same Olson module if and only if they're conjugated by GLn. So Tn, which for now seems a little mysterious. Is maybe more clearly understandable if you see it this way. So Tn corresponds to specifying a coset. Well, so you choose an element of Sn, and if you take, well, no, sorry. So T in Tn is a coset, well, is an element. So let me rewrite that up there. So, so Tn is the union for S in Sn of S mod Ms. So you look at your lattice, and you reduce it mod the maximal ideal. You get a k vector space, and you pick a point in it. A small k vector space. So you get a vector space over the residue field, and you pick a point in it. So you can check that T1 actually is this group. And so the other Tn's are higher dimensional versions of it. So this group is really a non-split extension of the residue field by the value group. So you have k, T1, V of k star. Yes, I'm sorry. K usually denoted multiplicatively, and this one is usually denoted additively, so we get into this very silly situation where I want a 1 on the left and a 0 on the right. But yes, it's a non-split extension, and so the fiber above well, so if you look at the O module, the rank 1 free O module of K, which is O itself. If you look at its Rideau mod M, it's exactly the residue field. So the fiber above S above O, so the fiber above valuation 0 is the residue field, and then we have copies of the residue field that move along as the valuation changes. Well, not really copies of the K vector spaces that move along as the valuation changes. And so in the higher dimension, we have the same kind of things, except that now we have dimensional n things around. And so the important theorem is the following. So Haskell, Trotsky, and Person. Oh, I forgot to describe the language. Well, you can guess probably what the language is. So. So these are all elements of ACFEQ, and we're going to look at the part of STFEQ that only concerns those. So we start with, we have the ring language, and we add sorts for each of the SNs, and sorts for each of the TNs, and we add the projection. And we have a map sigma n from the ln of k Sn, and a map tau n from tlnk to tn. So this is going to be called the geometric language. And the important theorem is that ACVFG, so which is the LG theory of algebraically closed valued fields, has EI. Okay, so that exactly tells us that although you don't eliminate everything in the field, you eliminate everything once you add these sorts. Which seems like, well, we did have to add a lot, so it seems a little disappointing. But what we added actually are reasonably nice objects. In the sense that well, in many senses. So, for example, I don't know. They're reasonably nice for various reasons that I don't want to get into. But at least, I mean, we know exactly what they look like. So we can actually prove things about them. which we can't if we just say it's some imaginary, some quotient, and we have no idea what it looks like. We can't really prove anything about it. So this is a clear progress on the situation we had earlier. And so now what I want to prove is what happened. So if you remember Poisat's first two examples were ACF and DCF0. And so if we go with the belief that VDF-EC is really the valued version of DCF0, which we can argue about, because there are various ways in which you might want to add the valuation to DCF0. In particular, if you could also try to add a valuation to a DCF0 field and say that the valuation has nothing to do with the differential, with the derivation, and then you would also get something. But we'll go with the belief that VDF-EC is the one that's geometrically reasonable. Because in a way, it's the theory, contractive valued differential fields are really more or less what you want to look at if you want to look at differential arc spaces. So we'll go with the fact that contractive is a geometrically reasonable assumption. And so the question is, does the result about without derivation somehow extends to the result with derivation? The question is, what about VDF-EC? And so the theorem is that everything works. So VDF-ECG so LG theory of VDF-EC. So what's interesting here is that so in the same ways that in the algebraic case, adding a differential didn't add any new quotients. Here we have the quotients that are added by the valued field, but nothing more. And so this is the theorem I want to at least start explaining how you prove. So how long do I have?
You can certainly talk for another half an hour.
So how do we prove that thing? The way we prove it is essentially by doing a valued version of a certain proof that DCF0 eliminates imaginaries. So let's look at how do we see that DCF0 eliminates imaginaries. So first, DCF0. So how do we do things in DCF0? Well, if we start with a differential variety, as I told you earlier, what we really want to do is find a field of definition for this thing. So what we can do is first move from this differential affine variety, which is a differential object that a priori we can't describe in purely field terms, into an infinite object that is described in purely field terms. So we go to what I will denote x infinity, which is the infinite prolongation of x. So I don't know how you want me to define this thing, but really what it is the limit of the xn, where xn is the Zariski closure of x dx dnx for x and x. And so this now is a purely algebraic object. And by EI in ACF, we find a field of definition for this thing. Okay, so you might be unhappy because this is an infinite object. So I only told you that we could find a field of definitions for finite dimensional object, but really what you do is just find a field of definition for x as vxn, and this is the same data. So that's how you can reduce the proof of DCF0 to really just knowing about ACF. So that's the proof we want to copy. You might notice that at some point I take a cyclic closure, which is something that is completely not available in a valued setting. Well, I could take the cyclic closure, but it's not going to describe the valued type. It's just going to describe the field type. So I need to rephrase this proof in slightly different terms. And so the way I'm going to do it is by going to types. So so what do we do? Yes. So if you allow me to rephrase this proof. So when we have x, which is affine differential variety, actually now we only need to know that it's L ring union D definable in DCF 0. The first thing we do is we replace this thing by its generic type. So we find a type P, which is definable over. I need to define a little something first. So if we remember about our EQ construction, it's obvious if anything is the field of definition what it should be. So if we look at K is some model is the model of DCF0 we're working in, and so in KEQ you can look at A, which is the set of points fixed by all automorphisms of x that fixed point of O of KEQ, that fix x globally. So that's a set inside KEQ, which really is the field of definition inside MEQ, well, inside KEQ, except that it's not a field because it has imaginary elements all over the place. And so if anything is the field of definition, it has to be the intersection of A with the field. What we do now is that we replace x by a type. So now we find P, a complete type, which is the most generic possible. And the way we're going to say it's the most generic possible, although that's not clearly a notion of genericity because it could also mean that P is very small. But the way you usually do it is by taking the thing that has the least, that solves all the equation it should, but nothing more. But you could also do it otherwise. So what I'm going to get to say now, it doesn't imply that it's a large type in any way, because I'm just asking that it is. So this thing, I'm going to call that LD, so the language of differential rings, which is LD A intersect K definable. So it doesn't, so it's a type which doesn't move when x itself does not move. And then when we have this type pin, we can look at the type that I'm going to call pin infinity, which is the push forward, which is the type of x, dx, dnx, and so on and so forth, over k, for any, so maybe I should, for any x realizing p. So you take a point in the type, you look at the set you get by taking all the differentials, and then you look at the type of this thing.
And this is in the restricted language.
In the ring language.
Yeah.
So this is exactly what the generic type, the field generic type of X infinity is.
But you forget the evaluation information?
No, so I mean DCF zero for now.
Oh, sorry.
And now you have this type inside. You have this type. So this is an ACF type. Sorry. We don't know. We don't know elimination of imaginaries yet. That's the whole point. We don't know elimination of imaginaries yet. So what it really is definable in LEQ over A. And because ACF, because we know that ACF has so by ACF, right? So this type is also it's ring EQ definable over A. Except here I'm being slightly abusive because I've lost some information. Here I'm only the ring EQ, so I've actually started ignoring all the differential EQ salts already. So really, I should intersect with KQ for the field. And we know that actually KQ for the field is just the field itself. So by ACFEQ, P infinity is L ring of A intersect K defined. And it's easy to find a way to see that P is L ring A intersect K definable from that. P is L ring A intersect K, L ring, so L bar, that's right, definable. Yeah, because if you know how to define P infinity, the way you define P is just by saying, if I have a formula that's applied to a certain number of differential, this formula is in the type. If the formula where I forget that it's applied to differential, but it's now applied to a tuple of variables, is actually in P infinity. So this is definable over this very set of parameters. And so that implies, so here I'm lying again. That implies that X is LD A intersect K definable. So here I'm lying again, because if X has lower dimensional components, it's not true. So you have to be a little more careful than that. So it's true when X is the class of an L-definable equivalence relation. Because if you know a point, you know the class. And the type gives you a point.
So did you say what P is to start with?
No, I didn't. I did quickly say what it was. It's the type that says I'm in X and I'm in no sub-differential variety.
And then you said, so that's what P is a complete type, and then from it you define P infinity.
Yes.
I'm a little confused. I mean, the differential affine variety can have components.
Yeah.
Yes.
Are your varieties irreducible?
I started with an irreducible
variety.
Right. To choose P, I have a collection of P's around, and I choose So actually, I don't really need to assume it's irreducible, if it's not irreducible, I just do it for one. Because as I told you, in the end, what I'm going to do is to apply it to the class of an equivalence relation, where I really only need to find one type that is consistent with X and which is definable over the right parameters. And so I just need to find one which is in one of the components. So So yeah, I'm going to give a little a sketch of what we did. So really, what we did. What is it? So what we did is rephrase elimination of imaginaries in